Hallelujah. Amen. Let us pray. Father, we thank you, Lord, for your word. We appreciate you for teaching us once again to learn your word. Father, I pray that as I speak your counsel, it will minister to the viewers and the hearers in the name of Jesus. Thank you, Heavenly Father. In Jesus' mighty name, I pray. Amen. Amen. Today, I continue my messages on the second coming of Jesus Christ. And today, I speak on the topic rapture. Rapture. Rapture is a subject or a topic that many people do not understand. A group of people some years ago, they began to train themselves how they are going to be raptured when Christ comes back, how they are going to fly, and such on funny things. You don't need to learn how to fly. You don't need to learn how to be caught up with the Lord in here. You don't need all those things. Automatically, there is a power that God will release that will make you magnetize of the Lord Jesus in the here. You don't need any training. You don't need anything to train you to how to fly, how to rapture. Those teachings are heretical. They are not part of what the Bible has set aside for us. You may say that you've gone through the Bible and you have never seen the word rapture in the Bible. Yes, it is true. The word rapture is coined out of the experience we are going to have together with the Lord. It is similar to magnetism. When you place an object here and you place a magnet close to it, something attracts the object to the magnet and they stick together. And that's what you call rapture in the area of theology. Rapture is the catching all of the saints in the head to meet Christ who pretend they are alive before the Father throne. Hallelujah. Where they are going to spend, they are going to remain in heaven during the period of tribulation. You see, immediately after the rapture, the Antichrist will begin to reign. It's going to reign for 7 years. So during the period of reigning, rapture must have taken place. The death in Christ will rise first to meet with the Lord in the air. And we that are alive, we shall be caught up together with them in the air. And then we are going to remain at God's throne for 7 years. Three and a half years of the reign of Antichrist will be very good. They begin to hate me as a good leader, this and that. But the last 3.5 years will be so worse. It will be so terrible that people will be despair for life. It will be terrible. I pray you will not be there in Jesus' name. You must have been raptured to heaven to meet that with the Lord Jesus Christ in the air. For this teaching, let me take us to 1 Thessalonians chapter 4. Look at 1 Thessalonians chapter 4 from verse 13. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4 from verse 13. But I will not have you to be ignorant, brethren, concerning them who are alive, that he sorrow not, even as though as others we have no hope. For if you believe that Jesus Christ died and rose again, even so then also we sleep in Jesus we God bring with him. For this we say unto you by the word of the Lord, that we which are alive and remain on the coming of the Lord shall not prevent them which are asleep. For the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, and with the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first. Then we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the air, in the clouds, to meet the Lord in the air, so and so shall we ever be with the Lord. Wherefore, comfort one another with these words. This passage explains what you call rapture, the catching up of the saints to meet with the Lord in here, presenting us alive before the throne of grace, and it's going to be during the period of the reign of the Antichrist, 7 years of the reign of the Antichrist. There are some lessons we need to learn from this passage. Number one, we need to learn the fact the Bible says we should not be ignorant. We should not be ignorant because ignorance is a sin. You cannot say that you are ignorant, you don't know the law, and you are breaking the law. No, you cannot say that. You should not be ignorant. It's a sin when you are ignorant.
Now, what's your concern? Then that are asleep, we should not be ignorant at all. You see, you have to really understand the fact that, yes, Jesus Christ has set things in order, and you have to obey what the word of God says. Do not be ignorant. Ignorance is not permissible in the law. Know the word, do not be ignorant, and serve the law. The second lesson we need to learn from it is that we should not be sad. When somebody is dead, we are sad. We meet the person, and maybe the person has got some family or some things he's doing, and just taking off like that. You see, Bible says we should not be sad if he's born again. On the last day, I want to tell you that we're going to see ourselves face to face, and we're going to recognize one another. We are going to recognize one another. Only that a new name will be given us in heaven. But we are going to recognize one another. Your friend that died ahead of you, you are going to see yourself in heaven, and you are going to be just, you are here, this and that. If the person is born again, you still see one on that. But if the person is not born again, it will be a kind of tough hell. You are not going to see. We shall not see one another. And that's the pitiable condition. You see, think about it. This world in which we are is temporal. This world in which we are is very temporal. Very shortly, we are going to be in eternity. Eternity either in heaven or hell. And look at it now. If somebody, when you get up there, and they are talking about this, or say, I passed through it just within, like 1 minute. Because the Bible says one day with the Lord is like 1 year, 1 year with the Lord is like 1 day. So you see, our years in this world is very short, very, very short, very short. You see, one day you are going to be with the Lord face to face, face to face. The 1 year the Lord promised us is even short compared to eternity. You are going to spend eternity either with God or with man. So that one should be what's giving you a hope. Very shortly, your friends that are dead, your family that are dead, you are going to see one another. If the person is born again, you are going to rejoice. Hallelujah. The third lesson we need to learn from rapture is that the dead in Christ and the living, they are going to partake of it. Anyone who has died several years ago is buried several years ago, and when rapture comes, he will come out of the grave. He put on an immortal body. An immortal body is a body that is not subjected to decay. It's not subjected to sickness or disease. He put up an immortal body, and we fly from different graves. Depending, we fly to heaven to go and be with the Lord in here. Bible says, then we that are alive, we shall not prevent them. We shall not precede those people flying. The first of all fly, the then they can fly first, and then we that are alive, we join them in the air. So we must not forget the fact that it is a noble experience with the Lord is telling us. Verse 15, for this we say unto you by the word of the Lord, that we which are alive and remain unto the coming of the Lord shall not prevent them which are asleep. Shall not prevent means precede. We shall not precede them that are asleep. The dead in Christ will rise first, and then we that are alive, we join them in the air, and so shall we ever be with the Lord. Praise the Lord. So let that one be your consolation. Your parents that died several years ago, they are born again, are going to see God to see one another. Your friends that are dead ahead of you, we are born again, they are still going to see one another. That is why I must evangelize and preach the gospel, because if people do not give their life to God and they die, you are going to lose them forever. But if they are Christians and they die, you see, we are going to receive one another, rejoice with another, and then we are going to rejoice that we make heaven. Hallelujah. Another thing we need to learn is that the second coming of Christ will be in pomp and glory. Many people have been speculating that Jesus Christ will come at one corner of Jerusalem, that the whole world will not see him, that only a few parts will see him. I read some commentary that said, Jesus Christ will not come like that too. He will come at the corner of Jerusalem that not all the world will see. This is heresy. The Bible didn't say that. Look at verse 16. For the Lord, he says, I descend from heaven. He will come down from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, the archangel, that is Archangel Gabriel, the one in charge of redemption, the one in charge of good news, the one that we help us in our flight to heaven. He will blow a trumpet with the voice of the archangel and the trump of God. The trump means trumpet, with the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first. For the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout. It's not going to be quiet. It's not going to, the whole world will hear the noise. The shout will come from one corner of the world to the other. Everybody will hear the noise. We hear the noise. And then you just discover that from different places, I pray that you not be an airplane that day, because if there is going to be in the airplane, it will not come, because the airplane will just open, it just fly. Different vehicles. People will get to fly on the sea, people will get to fly different places. We shall fly to meet with the Lord in the air. That is God's promise for us. God's promise for us is that it shall be like that. Hallelujah. So the second coming of Christ is not going to be quiet. It's not going to be noiseless. It's going to be with a trump, with pomp, with glory. Archangel will begin to blow the trumpet. Other angels will be there. They will usher us into heaven to meet with the Lord in the air. I pray that you will not miss heaven. In the mighty name of Jesus. All your activities here on the earth, you are doing one activity or another, you are carrying out one activity or another, doing this, doing that, remember there's heaven to gain and there's hell to lose. Remember, one day will be one day when you are going to meet with your Creator, eyeball to eyeball. And I also challenge you. You say you are young. You are not young. Teach us to number our days that we may apply our hearts unto wisdom. You are not young. I've not seen young people die. Old people are dying, young people are dying, even babies are dying. So you will meet your Father face to face. That's why you must straighten out your life with Jesus. If you are not born again, you must give that to Jesus so that you are part of those that will meet heaven, that you meet Jesus Christ in heaven to be with the Lord. Also, another lesson you need to learn there is that there is order in the kingdom of God. There's order of resurrection. There's another which you must not miss. The kingdom of God is not a facade. It's organized. Any organization that they have authority, they have the way it is, and it will run very well. But see, the kingdom of God is not an exception. That if you have organization that you are running, everything is in order. Don't think that the kingdom of God is in disorder. Everything will be in order. Resurrection is going to be in order. And let me read to you some passages, verses 16 and 17. For the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with his shout, with the voice of the archangel, and with the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first. The dead in Christ will rise first. That's another. Then we which are alive and remain. The dead in Christ will rise first. Then those of us that are alive and remain, the Bible says we shall be caught up together with them in the clouds. We shall be caught up together with them in the clouds. It's another. To meet with the Lord in the air. So shall we ever be with the Lord. Now, the Bible didn't say we that are alive will be raised up first. No, that's not the order. Everything is highly organized. It's another. The dead in Christ will rise first. They will go up first. And then we that are alive will begin to join them. And you discover the kind of urgency of the message. Apostle Paul that wrote this epistle, look at the way he addressed it. He addressed it as if he himself will be alive. He addressed it as if he himself will be alive. Because look at the way he said, then we who are alive. He didn't say that we that were alive. No, then we who are alive. He counted himself as part of the people that will be alive. He counted himself as part of those that will be alive, that you see the coming of Jesus Christ. So I'm encouraging you, it's coming very near, and you need to prepare for his coming, and you need to get yourself ready. And the coming of the Lord will be like a thief in the night, because God didn't tell us, I'm going to come by 10th of April, year 2012, no, year 2025, no, he didn't give us the date, but the signs of his coming, the signs of his coming, the thing that he said they are going to happen, they will still happen. They will still happen. These things will still happen. These things will still happen. All the things he said will happen, the flight of the aeroplane, submarine, earthquakes, tornado here and there, they have happened and have happened again. God allowed them to be repeated so that it will be a warning to us preparing for us. All those things that the Bible says will happen, they are happening. You prepare yourself for the coming of Christ, and the Lord God Almighty will see you through in the mighty name of Jesus. So another thing apart from the order of resurrection is that we need to learn about the eternity. We are going to spend eternity in two places. Eternity is a life without end. This one in which it has an end. Maybe a man just maybe 130 years, he need to be old, 130 years, or 80 years, or 90 years. Yes, I had the news of one of the generals in the kingdom, and I said, look, I passed away. You see, he gave me a sober reflection. There was a time that man was young. There was a time that man was jumping up and down, winning souls. Now the man has become very old, and now he has gone to glory. He has left this world and all the things inside it. He left it for us to continue. So where he has gone to is eternity. Eternity is a life without end. You spend it, there's no end. This one has an end. Maybe you are 70 years old, you are 80 years old, 90 years old. One day you are going to die. It has an end. But eternity is a life where you will not die. And you spend it either in heaven or in hell. In heaven to be with the Lord and rejoice. To be with the Lord and rejoice and say, thank you, Father. Finally, I make home. You see? But if it were to be hell, it also be life without end. The Bible says, where their worm does not die, the worm does not die, the pain is not abated. It said, there shall be weeping and gnashing of teeth. They will begin to be hellfire, begin to cry. It will not be your portion in Jesus' name. Eternity in hell is a life without end for the sinners. But heaven is for the believers. And that one gets me to a question. People normally say that, and whether you're going to make heaven or not, you don't know. You don't know. It's when you die, you will know. Or no mentola. That is, it's heaven that knows those people that be saved. No, it's a lie. If you are going to make heaven, you know from here. If you are going to make heaven, you will know from this world that yes, I'm going to heaven. If anybody asks you, where are you going to after now? You say, heaven is my place. I once met with a senior man of God. We went there to just greet him and relieve with him. The moment we entered it and we began to discuss with him, he said, he's heading for heaven. That anytime this guy comes, he knows he's going to heaven. He knows he's heading for heaven. That's it. Everybody will be sure he's heading for heaven. If you are not going to heaven, you will know. And the kind of death we die will be terrible. I've read the biographies of some believers. One of them, before he died, he said, I see fire burning. It's burning me. Where I'm going is very hot. Where I'm going is not good at all. That was his comment. And I read the biography of another man of God who said, I see angels. They are carrying me down home. And so on and so forth like that. So you will know whether you're going to make heaven or not here from this world. In order to make heaven, there's something you need to do. In order for you to make heaven, you must do something. And I want to tell you what to do. You must align yourself as a sinner. You see, you are not born to be a sinner. You are not born like this. Adam and Eve, they sold that to the devil. As that any person born by a woman is a sinner. Any person born by a woman is a sinner. You need to come to realization one day. You say, Lord, I'm tired of my lie. There's a vacuum in your heart that's seeking after God. There's a vacuum in your heart that's seeking after God. You need to come to Christ. Realize yourself as a sinner. Say, Lord, forgive me my sins. You can't continue to live like this. Forgive my sins. I surrender my sins unto you. Make me a child of God. Give me the power to live above sin. Lord, I give my life unto you today. You need to give your life to Jesus. Nicodemus came to Jesus and said, can a man be born second time? Say, do I need to die and be born again? Jesus Christ said, that which of the spirit is of the spirit. That which of the flesh is of the flesh. Except a man be born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. The second birth is a spiritual birth. It's not that you die, you are not born again. No, it's a spiritual birth. The time you need to come to Christ, say, Lord, forgive me my sins. I give my life unto you. I'm a sinner. I don't want to go to hell. Jesus Christ died for you. He carried your sins away. He died for you so that you might become a new person. 2 Corinthians 5:17 says, therefore, if any man be in Christ Jesus, he's a new creature. All things are passed away. All things will be passed away in your life. All things will become new. All things will be passed away in your life. All things will become new. Come to Christ today. Accept as your Lord and Savior. You can't argue with him. He created you. He created you. In the beginning, when God created the world, he spoke the world to existence. The word he spoke was Jesus Christ in the spoken form. Yes. So now you're led to Jesus. Accept as your Lord and Savior. He died because of you. Say, Jesus, today, take over my life. And if you mean it and you say that, I want to tell you that you will be born again. He doesn't take you to go and fast. He doesn't take you to go and do one kind of sacrifice or another. Just confess with your mouth. Believe in the Lord Jesus Christ. And then you will be born again. And after that, you join a church, begin to grow in the Lord, begin to read the Bible, begin to pray, begin to come to the Lord. You see, begin to do things that you know are present to the Lord. The Holy Spirit will begin to guide you. And then you will make heaven. It's my prayer that you will make heaven in Jesus' name. It's my prayer that on the day of the rapture, you will be one of those people that will be raptured and taken to heaven. That will be your testimony in the name of Jesus. If you are not born again, decide for Christ now. Let me pray for you. Heavenly Father, as many as have heard my word and they are giving their lives unto you, I pray that their names should be written in the book of life in the mighty name of Jesus. I pray, Lord God Almighty, you will save them. I pray, Lord God Almighty, you will deliver them from their predicament, from their sins, in the name of Jesus. As they give their life to you, Father, write their names in the book of life. Wash them in your blood. Wash them clean in your blood. Thank you, Heavenly Father. In Jesus' mighty name, we pray. As many as have given their lives to Christ through this medium, I want to write me, share your experiences with me. I'll be able to help you. I will send you material that will make help you grow in the name of Jesus. Also, I want to pray for those that are sick. You are sick in your body. Believe God for your healing. I want to tell you that going to the hospital these days is not easy. It is not easy to go to the hospital these days. But it is easy for Jesus to heal you. Close your eyes. And where you are listening to me, believe God with me and place your hand where the problem is. Father, in the name of Jesus, I pray for your children. As they are watching me, in the name of Jesus, I command every pain, every problem, every trouble in your heart to disappear in the name of Jesus. I rebuke sickness, disease in your life in the name of Jesus. And I declare that you are totally made whole in the mighty name of Jesus. Right now, receive your healing in the name of Jesus. The Bible says, if the Son has set you free, you will be free indeed. I declare total freedom from sickness, from oppression, from disease. Be free in the name of Jesus. Any tree that my Father has not planted shall be uprooted in the name of Jesus. Stranger will be afraid. They will come as a secret place of the body. Every stranger in your life, I command you to go out in the name of Jesus. Receive your miracles in the name of Jesus. Receive your need in the name of Jesus. You are healed in the mighty name of Jesus. Thank you, Holy Father. It is well with you. Your miracle is permanent. Your healing is permanent. By the stripes of Jesus, you are made whole. In the name of Jesus, by His stripes, you are made whole. In the name of Jesus, thank you, Holy Father. We give all the praise and all the glory. In Jesus' mighty name, we pray. Amen. 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 Praise the Lord. You are blessed of the Lord in Jesus' name. God bless you. Amen.